Father, we come today and we just thank you. We just praise you today. We just ask you today, God, to be with us and just to help us today, Father, and just to be with the many that are sick today, Father, and just help them and just to touch their bodies today, Father, and just the many others, Father, that are traveling. We're just going to ask you to give them traveling mercies today, Father, and we're just going to ask that you touch and be with each person that's here with us today and just help us to glorify you with our song and our worship today, Father, with the message, and we're just going to lift everything up and everyone up to you today. We just thank you in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Dark cavalry. Jesus loves me. We have come into His house and gathered in His name to worship Him. We have come into His house and gathered in His name to worship Him. We have come into His house and gathered in His name to worship Christ the Lord. Worship Him, Christ the Lord. Let's worship Him this morning. Let's forget about ourselves and concentrate on Him and worship Him. Let's forget about ourselves and concentrate on Him and worship Him. Let's forget about ourselves and concentrate on Him and worship Christ the Lord. Worship Him, Christ the Lord. Let us lift up holy hands and magnify His name and worship Him. Let us lift up holy hands, magnify His name, and worship Him. Let us lift up holy hands, and magnify His name, and worship Christ the Lord. Worship Him, Christ the Lord. Number two again. Let's forget about ourselves and concentrate on Him and worship Him. Let's forget about ourselves and concentrate on Him and worship Him. Let's forget about ourselves and concentrate on Him and worship Christ the Lord. Worship Him, Christ the Lord. Let us lift up holy hands, magnify His name, and worship Him. Let us lift up holy hands and magnify His name and worship Him. Let us lift up holy hands and magnify His name and worship Christ the Lord. Worship Him, Christ the Lord. Worship Him, Christ the Lord.
Amen. We got some birthdays too this morning.
All right.
We do. And guess whose birthday it is? Barbara Brown's got a birthday.
Barbara Brown.
All right. Also too, Crystal Acord has a birthday. I bet they made her a big birthday cake down at McDonald's, didn't they? Also too, Tina Maddox, little TT. Everybody knows that's Patsy and Cecil's daughter. She's had a big birthday. I've seen her on Facebook this week. That lady has sure loved her birthday this year.
Amen.
She's had a big birthday this year. And also, too, we've had an anniversary that was Walter and Priscilla, I guess that's what her name is. Patricia, I'm sorry. Yeah. Patricia, Walter and Patricia.
I say, Brother Cecil's probably still celebrating. So. A happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Every day of the year, may you feel Jesus near. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. And the best years you ever had.
Happy anniversary
to you. Happy anniversary to you. Every day of the year, may you feel Jesus near. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. And the best years you ever had. Amen.
Amen.
Try another one.
Yeah, let's do a glory to you. All right, that's a D, isn't it?
Yeah. Down at the cross where my Savior died, downward for cleansing from sin I cried. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to I am so wondrously saved from sin. Jesus so sweetly abides within. There at the cross where he took me in. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood. Glory to his name. O precious fountain that saved from sin, I am so glad I have entered in. There Jesus saves me and keeps me clean. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Come to this fountain so rich and sweet. Cast thy poor soul at the Savior's feet. Plunge in today and be made complete. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name.
If you don't care, start turning your Bibles to Micah chapter 6. This morning we're going to be at Micah chapter 6. We're going to be looking at the first 8 verses of that chapter. It's a very interesting set of events that take place there. And what we're going to look at is actually God indicting the Israelites, or it's kind of set up like a trial or a court hearing is really the way that it's laid out in front of us. But when we start looking at it, the title this morning is Doing the Right Thing. And as we get through it, you'll understand kind of what I'm talking about there. But when we think about doing the right thing, a lot of times we think in terms of we have good intentions and want to do the right thing, but a lot of times our actions don't match our intentions, do they? And that's kind of where we are going to, kind of the direction that we're going to go in this morning. And I wanted to start out, though, reading Romans chapter 7, verse 15. This is Paul talking, and he says, "I do not understand what I do, for what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do." Anybody ever feel like that? Yeah, you do not understand what you do. Anybody like that? Yeah, why did I do that? Why in the world did I do that? Most of the time for me, it's why in the world did I say that? Why did I open my mouth? It says, "For what I want to do, I do not do." Now, I have good intentions, but the intentions don't pan out. And he says, "But what I hate, I do." And we do that a lot of times. We kind of do things like that. We have really good intentions and want to do the right thing in a lot of situations, a lot of circumstances. But when things end up, when we wind up over here at the end of things, our actions don't match up with what our intentions are. And there's lots of reasons why that is. Because when we set out to do things, we have good things in mind. But because of pressure and because of stress and because of all the things that go on, by the time we get over here to what we actually wanted to do, it turned out completely different. We have peer pressure that comes in. Even as adults, we have peer pressure, don't we? We sure do, because we got people that we're so afraid of what others will think or how others will respond or what other people will say about things that it kind of drives us to kind of not do things the way that we actually intended to do it. We kind of water things down a little bit, or we tend to not be as blunt and as straightforward as sometimes we need to be. Our intentions, sometimes it's out of selfishness. Did you know that? Because sometimes doing the right thing involves us denying ourselves. It involves us submitting ourselves to God. It involves us doing what God has called us to do. And we don't want to deny ourselves for anything, do we? It's not fun to deny yourself, is it? And we don't want to do that. That's human nature. We don't want to do that. But Jesus says this. This is Luke chapter 14, verse 26. He says, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and his mother, his wife and his children, his brothers, his sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple." Now Jesus isn't saying hate everybody. He's saying put God first. He's saying if God's not first above all these other things and all these other people, God has to come first. God's will has to come first, is what he's saying. He says, if you put anything before God, you can't be my disciple. That's harsh, isn't it? Because we love our families, don't we? Most of them. We love our friends. Most of them, anyway. You got to take it up with him later. But if he's saying, if we don't love God first and put God first, all these other things aren't going to matter because you're not going to be God's disciple anyway. So go ahead and love everything and everybody and be as nice as you want to be. But if you want to be God's disciple, you love God first and you put God first in your life. And you respond first to God. And you put yourself out a little bit for God's sake. You know, for the sake of the people. Do what God has called you to do. That's what he's saying. That's all he's saying. But at the root of it all, to be honest with you, is sin. It's not a sin as far as action. It's the sinful human nature that has got to be dealt with. So go back to Romans chapter 7, where I'm going to pick up the rest of what Paul said there. He says in verse 17, "As it is no longer I myself who do it, but it is sin living in me." He's saying, sin living in me, the sinful nature is causing me to react in ways that God does not intend. And it's got to be dealt with. He says, "I know that nothing good lives in me, that is, in my sinful nature. In myself, nothing good lives in me." There's nothing good within me that's pleasing to God because it's covered by this sinful nature. He says, "For I have the desire to do what is good, but I can't carry it out." Desire is good, but unless you can carry it out, what good is it? He says, for what I do is not the good I want to do. No, the evil I do, not want to do, this I keep on doing. Defeated. These good intentions, I want to do good, I don't want to do bad. I don't want to sin, but I do it anyway. Because the sinful nature is in control. God's not in control. The Holy Spirit is not in control. We're holding on to that for ourselves. And he says, now if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it is sin living in me that does it. The sinful nature is what's driving it and causing these things to happen. And it's what causes Paul to have all these good intentions. Now we think about Paul. We don't think Paul ever did anything bad after he was saved. But apparently Paul wasn't perfect either. Which is good because none of us are. Paul's saying, I had all these good intentions and wanted to do all these great things. But my actions aren't matching what my intentions are. And why is that? And he had to discover that that sinful nature within him had to be dealt with once and for all before his actions could actually match his intentions. Otherwise, he's leading a defeated life, a life of no victory, and he's going to be frustrated, constantly upset, trying to battle within himself on what he wants to do and how he's going to do it. Does it sound familiar? A constant internal struggle. That's what he's talking about. But it's no excuse, is it? No. Because God gives us a way. That sinful nature has to be dealt with, and it's dealt with through the Holy Spirit. Releasing ourselves to the Holy Spirit. He deals with the sinful nature. And we're able to overcome that. And we're able to make that choice that I'm not going to do that today. I'm not going to live like that today. I'm going to live for God. I'm going to do what God says. And we gain victory. And a lot of that frustration tends to kind of go away. And see, this is the situation that the Israelites were in at this time. And Micah is going to give them a word from God. It's a prophecy from God. He's going to tell them what God is saying to them. Because they're going to say, well, at least I had good intentions. Well, whoop-de-doo. We can have all the good intentions we want. But unless we back that up with actions, they're meaningless. Kind of when the rubber meets the road, we've got to start living and acting the way that we say. We've got to start practicing what we preach. Y'all have heard that. We've got to start being doers of the word and not hearers only. We've got to reach that place. And God is going to confront Israel with this same thing. It's no different. And he says here, I'm going to read Micah chapter 6, starting in verse 1. He says, listen to what the Lord says. Stand up, plead your case before the mountains. Let the hills hear what you have to say. Hear, O mountains, the Lord's accusation. Listen to your everlasting foundations of the earth. For the Lord has a case against his people. He says, he is lodging a charge against Israel. My people, what have I done to you? How have I burdened you? Answer me, God says. He says, I brought you up out of Egypt and redeemed you from the land of slavery. I sent Moses to lead you and Aaron and Miriam. He says, my people, remember what Balak, the king of Moab, counseled and what Balaam, the son of Beor, answered. Remember your journey from Shittim to Gilgal that you may know the righteous acts of the Lord. He says, with what shall I come before the Lord and bow down before the exalted God? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgressions, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? It says in verse 8, he has showed you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. To do the right thing. That's what he requires. That's all he requires. It's not sacrifices and rams and goats and bulls. Just do the right thing. Just do the right thing. So I read it. But let's break it down, because you read all that, it's kind of like, okay. It's kind of hard to wrap our heads around what God's talking about here. But He's confronting them for their sin. And He's trying to set up this scene. Now, they didn't have courtrooms like what we have courtrooms now. They did court in a different way. But there was a judge that sat before them, and they brought their cases before that judge. We do kind of the same thing. And that's what He's trying to set up and get them to visualize in their mind. And He says in verse 1 again, He says, "Listen to what the Lord says. Stand up and plead your case before the mountains. Let the hills hear what you have to say." And He's saying, the earth is your courtroom. Israel, you are the defendant. The mountains are the jury. And God is the judge. And they're confronted now with the reality of their situation. Because for years, they have said all the right things. They put on the nice outward appearance of being who God had called them to be. But inwardly, they were not. They had honored God with their lips, but their hearts were far from Him. For years, for decades, for generations. That comes out of Isaiah 29, is when God said that. That was before this even happened. They were still doing that. Honoring God with their lips, but their hearts were so far from Him. So far. And now God's calling them on the carpet for it. He's calling them out on their sin. He's calling them out, and it's time for them to stand up and defend themselves, to offer their defense for why they're doing this, for why they lack the follow-through that God required, for why they didn't love God with all their heart, their mind, their soul, why they had never fully submitted to God, why they weren't living up to what they were claiming. He's calling them out for it. He says, "Stand up, O Israel, and plead your case before the mountains. Let the hills hear what you have to say." Now let's translate this into 2017. Stand up, Christian, and plead your case before God, before the mountains. Let the hills hear what you have to say. Why do we lack the follow-through that God requires? Why do we fail to love God with all of our heart, our mind, our soul? Why do we fail to love our neighbor like ourselves? Why do we reject God's commands? Why do we not submit to God? Why are we honoring Him with our lips, but our hearts are far from Him? Why are we doing that? Why do our actions and our intentions not match up with one another? What's our defense? What's our excuse this morning? It's what He's asking. And we say, "Oh, I love God." Is there proof of it? Is there any proof that you love God with all of your heart, your mind, your soul? We're talking about the courtroom. Let's just talk about another analogy. This was an old saying. I don't know how long it's been around. But if you were hauled into court and you were accused of being a Christian, is there enough evidence to convict you of it? Honestly. Or are we kind of hiding our Christianity? Call them undercover Christians. Keeping it all to ourselves. Because we're afraid of what people will say or how people will react or how they'll act around us. Or maybe it's because we're ashamed. Because we know we're not living up to the standards that God set. We're not doing what God's called us to do. We're under conviction. That could be why too. I don't know the reason. Everybody's got their own reasons. But just like Israel was appearing before God at that time, this is what Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians 5. He says, "We must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive what is due him for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad." See that? All must appear before the judgment seat of Christ. There is no exception. None. No exception. If you're breathing this morning, you will stand before the judgment seat of Christ one day. All that have come before us. They talked about the cemetery this morning. All of those people out there in that cemetery will stand before the judgment seat of Christ. All that come after us will stand before the judgment seat of Christ. There is no exception. There's no loophole, no way around it, no way out. We will all stand. And what will our defense be? Are we going to say, oh, I had good intentions. Oh, I wanted to do the right thing. It's not going to cut it. It's not going to cut it. Jesus tells us this in Luke chapter 9. He says to them, then he said to them all, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself daily, take up his cross, and follow me. That's what Jesus said. And he goes on after that in verse 24, for whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me will save it. What good is it for a man to gain the whole world and yet lose or forfeit his very self or lose his soul? What good is it to gain the entire world and lose your soul? What good is it to own every house and property in Lincoln County and you lose your soul? What good is it? What good is it to have 25 brand new vehicles, 18 brand new houses, $100 zillion in the bank if you're going to lose your soul in the end? Because it's all worthless. In God's kingdom, it's worthless. I don't think we're going to have cars in heaven. We may, I don't know. I kind of like the idea of just kind of flying around, not having to worry about it. Because you got a car, you're going to have insurance. But the point is, none of those things matter in God's kingdom. None of them. None of them. And I read that verse because it also tells us that we have got to be all in on this thing. We can't be halfway in, halfway out. We can't be over here one day, over here one day. We've got to be all in for God. We've got to give ourselves fully to God. And that's all he's saying to the Israelites. I just want you to give yourself fully to me, to be all in on this thing. And they weren't. They definitely weren't. Because this is what he says in verse 2. He says, hear, O mountains, the Lord's accusation. Listen, you everlasting foundation of the earth, for the Lord has a case against his people. He is lodging a charge against Israel. You think he's got a case against us? He does. Here's some good news. I'm going to read you some good news. You ready for it? 1 John chapter 2, verse 1 says this, my dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have one who speaks to the Father in our defense, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. Do you hear that? If you are a Christian, you have an advocate. You have a defense attorney. That's Jesus Christ. He is the one that stands in the gap and he defends us before God the Father, before the judgment seat. No, he doesn't say, oh, they're not guilty, they didn't do anything. He says, have mercy because I paid the penalty. I paid the price. I took care of it. They don't have to worry about it because I took care of it. That's what Jesus does. That's what he does for us. And that's the good news. Because I won't ask you to raise your hand if you've never sinned, because I don't want you to sin and lie. Because we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Every single one of us. Every one of us. But there's more to that verse than just that second part. We love the second part. Because we kind of breathe easy after that. Because you're like, whoo, look at the first part. He says, I write this so that you will not sin. Mm-mm. And then he goes on, he says, if anybody does sin. You notice he doesn't say when, he says if. It's not an excuse, it's not a way out to just go out and do whatever you want. Say, oh, I'm covered, it's okay, God took care of it. No. Paul tells us in Romans, they ask him the same question. He says, God forbid you do that. Because what happens is when Christ saves you, he changes you. And you don't desire to do those things. That's what Paul was saying in Romans 7. He says, I don't desire to do those things, but I can't figure out why I still do. That was early on. But Paul figured it out. Lay it all down before God. Let the Holy Spirit be in full, total control of my life. And we'll have victory. Now, will we never, ever, ever, ever sin again? That's not what it's saying. He's saying the intention is that you don't, but if you do, meaning that we're supposed to be growing as Christians. We're supposed to be learning how not to fall into those traps and those temptations. Learning how to obtain that victory. And getting closer to closer to closer to closer to God. That's how we gain the victory. And quit making excuses for when we sin. Don't make excuses for it. Repent, move on, and don't do it again. That's what it boils down to. You don't just make it, oh, well, I couldn't help it. Yes, you could. If you are claiming Christ, yes, you can. You can help it. You're just not wanting to help it. You're not wanting to let the Holy Spirit have control. You're not wanting to give up to the Holy Spirit. You want to hang on to it. Just let it go. And you'll have victory, or whatever it is. We'll say, I'm too hard, it's too hard, I'm too busy, I can't do this, I can't do that, I don't understand. We make it too complicated. We try to make it too complicated. In Micah 6:3, he says this, My people, what have I done to you? How have I burdened you? Answer me. Because we say it's such a burden. How have I burdened you? Jesus tells us at Matthew 11, He says, Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, and for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. My yoke is easy, my burden is light. Come to Jesus, give it to Jesus, let Him have it. It's not to be a burden, it's to give us victory, it's to free us. And that's what he said, Micah 6:4, he says, For I brought you out of Egypt and redeemed you from the land of slavery. I sent Moses to lead you, also Aaron and Miriam. My people, remember what Balak, the king of Moab, counseled and what Balaam, son of Beor, answered. Remember your journey from Shittim and Gilgal, that you may know that the righteous act of the Lord. He's basically saying, remember from where God brought you from. Remember the place that God brought you from. How far has God brought us this morning? Did He not redeem us from slavery and bondage of sin and death? Has He not been there leading us and guiding us from the beginning? Has He not been with us? What's holding us back? Why are we refusing to fully give ourselves to God? He's given us everything He could. He gave us all. He gave us Himself. I think we're kind of like the Israelites. We're putting our faith in these empty sacrifices. These things that we think are going to gain us some merit. These honoring God with our lips, but not with our heart. Verse 6, he says this, With what shall I come before the Lord and bow down before the exalted God? Shall I come before Him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? We can offer any kind of sacrifice we want. We can attend all the church services we want. We can do all the activities we want. We can give all the money we want. And I encourage you to do so. We can dress up all we want. But if our heart doesn't belong to God, it's just for show. It's just a show. It's just something to ease our conscience a little bit. But none of them will save you. None of them will save your soul. Only faith in Jesus can do that. And all these other things are good things. But they're the fruit of salvation. They're not the saving things. They're the things that are the result of salvation. These are the things that naturally flow out of us after we're saved. After we've given our heart to God. It's when our actions and our intentions begin to line up. It's when it matters. And this is the best way I can explain it. Do you want to be a Christian this morning? Everybody in here probably says, yes, I do. Well, that's an intention. That's a good intention. Have you stepped up and made the choice necessary to turn that intention into an action? To make it real, to make it more than just a good thought? Because that's what it takes. There has to be some type of action involved. For those of us who have came to Christ, do our intentions and our actions might line up? Do they match up? Or we continue to struggle like Paul did, like what he talked about here? Have you submitted yourself fully to God this morning is what it boils down to. Have you given the Holy Spirit that necessary access to your life, to your heart? Don't build it up in your mind like it's some big difficult chore or challenge. It's just giving yourself to God. It's just turning it over, letting go of it. He finishes up, he says, He has showed you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. That's all it's required. To do the right thing. To do what in your heart you know is true, you know is right. To do what God is calling you to do. What's God speaking into your heart this morning? What's He telling you the right thing to do is? And what will you choose to do about it? That's all we're talking about. Dale, do you care to come and play something or sing or whatever, you and Jack, or whatever the Lord leads you, puts on your all's heart? So I'm going to give you all an opportunity to respond to what the Lord has spoke to you today. Whatever it is, I don't know. But the Lord has spoke to all of us in here today one way or another. And we will respond and make a choice one way or another. And it's our, whatever we choose will be the choice we make. Nobody else is responsible but you. Stand with me. Father, we come and I thank You and praise You today. I ask You to bless and be with each one that's here today, family. Each family that's represented, I ask You to help them, Father. And I ask You to go before us and help all of us, Father. I ask You to be with us today as we go about. Just help us to glorify You in everything that we do, everything that we say today, Father. I ask You to help us to be a witness for You, Father. I ask You to touch the bodies of those that are sick this morning. I ask for a healing today, Father. I ask You to intervene in the situation with Stella and her lupus, Father. And I ask You to help her, Father. I ask You to touch Gloria today, Father, and just to help her in her body today, Father. I ask You to be with Rose, Father, these next several months, Father. I ask that You touch her, Father, that there be no adverse effects, no reactions, Father, that everything goes smoothly, Father. And the others, Father, that are sick, the others that are on our heart today, I ask You to touch and be with them. Guide us today and just help us. And we thank You and praise You in Jesus' name. Amen.